Okay, I need somebody to stand up. I think it should be you, because you're looking around wanting to be somebody else. Okay, this is a litter ball. It has some books. Oh yeah, stand up. So this ball has letters on it. That's why it's called a letter ball. We're very creative in the field of neuroscience. So I'm gonna have you catch this ball. Watch out. I want you to say the letter that you see right before you catch it. So I don't want you to catch it and look and say C. I want you to say A. So the letter you see right before you catch it.
Okay.
Hands up, ready?
P.
Nice, give it back.
C. C.
Good, that's yours.
Oh.
I've got more. Somebody else stand up. We're training your vision right now. Oh. I don't have good insurance, so I'm gonna come around here. Ready? Ready, hands up.
T.
Cool. Cool.
A.
Good. That's yours. Keep it. Nice. So what this is doing right now is it's training your ability to track with your eyes. So if you are an athlete and you need to catch a ball, you need to have the ability to watch it all the way through the air from the time it leaves the thrower's hand to the moment that you catch it. And a lot of times we have holes in our eye tracking. So you'll see it here in the thrower's hand, you'll see it here somewhere in the middle, and you'll see it right before it hits you in the face. So right now we're trying, somebody else stand up. We're training, yeah? All right. We're training your ability to track with your eyes. Oh, don't look so scared. I'm gonna throw it really well. Ready? Nice job. Well, you're much better than that than I was when I first started. Nice, good job. All right, try one more time. Say it in the air. Good job. You can hold on to that. That's yours. Take it home. Play with it. Make everybody you know play with it. Okay, let's do one more. Somebody else, stand up. Okay. It's not you I'm concerned with. It's me, but we're going to. Whoever's wearing glasses, maybe take them off. I don't know. I'm not awesome with the aim.
A.
Good. Luckily, so this trains your ability to catch, not so much your ability to throw. But I seem to be doing okay so far. All right, that's an eye tracking issue. We can work on that. One more. Ready?
Yeah.
Keep it. That's yours. Sweet. I'm going to keep doing that because I think you guys are going to get really bored after I talk for a little while. So if I start to see you fading, I have a lot of balls. I also have candy, so I'm just trying really hard to win you over at the start so that this goes a little bit easier for me. So anytime anybody looks like they're starting to kind of go away, you're going to get one of these in the face. So hopefully you have really good visual tracking skills. Otherwise, right in the face. There we go. She's got it. Okay, so raise your hand if you wish something was different about your life. Cool. We're going to start to make a little list. Anything you want to change that you can share. So this can be something you don't want to do anymore, you want to do more of, pain you don't want to have anymore, want to run faster, want to read faster. Somebody start calling them out.
I want to have nice knees. No.
Okay. Nice knees. Can I have healthier knees, more functioning knees? I don't know. What does nice mean?
Healthier ligaments.
Okay. All right. So are you an athlete?
Yeah.
Okay. What's your sport? Very nice. All right. Somebody just keep shouting them out.
I
want
to be able to see well.
Okay. Good thing you're here. We'll get you a ball. Who said that? Okay. Stand up. Ah, okay. How much vision do you have?
About 2400.
Okay. Hold on to this. This is for you. And we're going to do this separately later.
Okay.
But that's for you. Okay, see well. What else? Start shouting them out.
Wake up earlier.
Wake up easier, I'm going to put. All right, keep going. I need at least 10.
Money.
Guess what? Me too. So if you figure that one out, let me know. Okay. Botch surgery. We'll be good friends by the end of this lecture. Down with the medical man. No? Okay. Stress. All right. Good. What else? Ah, that's an awesome one. Good job. All right. What else? What was that? Okay. Somebody else? Ah, that's good. What kind of endurance?
Like running endurance.
Cool. This is procrastination is a very long word. Can you keep the word shorter, please? Endurance. What else? Okay. Give me two more.
Better
rising
skills. More spiritual.
Okay. Good. That's a good start. Cool, this is gonna be a list that we go back to quite a lot of times during the course of this lecture. So, we're talking about change here. What is brain training? Just, I wanna know everything you guys know about this topic. So, raise your hand. I'm gonna just put some candy in my hand if that makes you wanna raise your hand more. Yes, sir.
Well, you see this thing, brain games on TV about neuroplasticity.
Mm-hmm. Okay, ready? Coming at you. Hands up. Cool. What? Bam. You know, you already got a ball, so you don't get two things. Who knows something else about brain training?
Continual learning.
Continual learning. Sure.
I don't want.
Yep. That's coming at you anyway. No.
No.
Oh, I should have brought like what something healthier. Don't tell my clients that this is the candy that I bought. It has all the chemicals in it that I tell them not to eat, but it was the cheapest. So, brain training. Do you know anything about brain training? No. Anybody? Somebody's got to know something.
It's easier when you're younger.
Is it? Okay. I don't necessarily agree with you. I'll still give you candy. You'll understand why when we start to talk about neuroplasticity. Anybody else? Anything? Okay. Who said that? Okay.
I got a ball.
You just love candy. Just not this guy. I don't like the way you're looking at me. All right. So, when we're talking about brain training, we're talking about neuroplasticity. So neuroplasticity, the brain is plastic, right? So it's the brain's ability to actually physically change based on the experiences and the information that we give to it. So when we're talking about neuroplasticity, I want you to imagine a camera. So think about the film in the camera. That film is blank. If I take a picture of you, then the light comes in, the camera works, I'm not a photographer, something happens. There's a picture of you on the film now, right? So experience changed that piece of film. Taking the picture, that experience actually changed what was on that piece of film. So in your body, your brain is like the film in a camera. So experience can actually change your brain because your brain is plastic at any age. Anytime we give our brain a new experience, we have re-neural wiring and things can change and it's all very cool. So the brain is change. Everything, anything that you want to change up there, you're going to have to change the way your brain is perceiving that activity. So I'd be hard-pressed to believe, I know we only got about 10 things on the board there, that there's anybody here who doesn't want to change something about their lives. Everybody's got something they want to train in. So brain training is relevant to each and every one of you, whether you consider yourself a sports athlete or not. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about, my background. I'm not used to, there's like seven microphones on me. It seems very elaborate. So I know I'm a personal trainer. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But whether you are a sports athlete or not, brain training is relevant to you if there is literally anything in your life that you wish was a little bit different. So every day, whether you know it or not, your brain is processing information. And learning how to harness that to create the change that you want for yourself, that's neuroplasticity, and that's what we're talking about today. So before we talk about that, I want to tell you a little bit about myself and how I got wrapped up in this crazy world of neuroscience. I grew up studying musical theater, so my parents were very excited when I was like, I'm going to study brains now, because to them I think it was a little bit more of a practical field than singing. But I grew up singing and dancing. I never actually thought I was very good in school. I was terrible at science, terrible at math. I got into my dream school, which was Penn State. I see we're in Michigan State, so we'll have a talk after. So Penn State School of Theater, they take 10 kids every year, 5 girls, 5 boys, and I got in. I was very excited. And then on my first night of my first spring break home from college, I got into an accident. And I'm going to tell you the story of the accident because I think you will appreciate it. Does anybody in here know anything about musical theater? Okay, good. So I've got a couple people in the crowd. So there'll be like five chuckles at this. So I was on my way to my old high school to see a production of The Wizard of Oz. So now I've lost like 40% of the room. So I'm going to keep going now. Just the few musical theater people in here. So I'm on my way to see a production of The Wizard of Oz. I'm in my car. I'm like 3 minutes away from my house. A freak tornado comes, rips a utility pole out of the ground, sucks it up into the sky, turns it on its side, and brings it through my car on the way to see The Wizard of Oz. Raise your hand if you got the funny in that. God, there's a lot more of you than I thought that there was going to be, so good. I'm feeling a lot better about how this is going. So I'm in the car, crushed under the utility pole. All the wires came down, and the car was electrocuted. I had a concussion. I broke my neck, my back. It destroyed every part of me, and one arm was through one windshield, and one part of me was through the front windshield, and somehow I survived all of those injuries and avoided paralysis, and that was super cool. And then 2 months later, I was undergoing arthroscopic knee surgery. So raise your hand if you've had that, because that's very common. Yeah. So I had just been in The Wizard of Oz, in my own little sick production of The Wizard of Oz, survived. I went in to get arthroscopic knee surgery. The surgeon severed a nerve in my knee, didn't tell me about it. One thing led to another, and now I have complex regional pain syndrome. So that is a nerve sensitivity disorder. So my right leg is incredibly sensitive to the touch. So for instance, I can't really wear jeans for a while. I couldn't even sleep under a sheet. It's very, very hard for me to wear pants at all, so you're welcome. I did that just for you. I don't wear pants often. Put them on tonight. So that's how I got here. I was very, very disillusioned with the medical world and the physical therapy world, and I had just terrible, terrible physical therapy experiences that if anybody wants to get coffee, they're very funny stories. I've had a lot of very funny things happen to me in hindsight, a lot of crying while it was happening, but a lot of laughing afterward. And so I just was getting nowhere. I was like 3 years into my recovery, and I couldn't walk, and I couldn't, you know, do anything that I loved, and all my doctors said, you'll never dance again, and I have suddenly had no career, so I was looking for one of those. But I had to drop out of school. So also, there's no vetting process, by the way, to be a speaker here. I haven't even graduated college, so I don't know what you thought you were getting, but here I am. So I left school, I went back home to my parents, and nobody could help me. So I started doing research myself, and I started studying corrective exercise. And at first I studied traditional corrective exercise, because that was, you know, the most, what's the word I'm looking for? Available, I guess. All my pain was neurogenic. So doing traditional mechanical-based physical therapy and personal training, it was getting me nowhere fast. And then I learned about brain training accidentally because I went up to a guy to make fun of him because he was wearing ridiculous shoes. He was wearing the toe shoes. So I went up to him to make fun of him about the toe shoes, and he ended up, you know, training my brain. And so I found myself studying at a company called Z Health, which is located here in Tempe. By the way, I'm from New York. I only just moved here a couple months ago. Somebody stand up. I just want to make sure we're all, oh, yeah, okay. Put your stuff down, hands up. Oh, were you here when we started this in the beginning?
No.
Oh, okay. So I'm going to say the letter you see right before you catch this.
Okay.
Okay, ready? C. Cool, try and call it in the air. Nice, much better. One more.
See.
That's for you. Keep it. Woo. Nice, cool. I just thought I'd break it up. Getting bored of my story. I'm getting bored of my own story. So I found brain training and here I am. We're gonna talk about brains today. I know is ridiculous. I don't do technology. I couldn't figure out how to make the PowerPoint. So I know you can't read it. I'm gonna read it to you. I could have made you a packet. Don't like computers, don't own a printer. So I just moved, have some, you know, pity on me. So does anybody have any questions so far? We haven't covered anything, but I really just want this to be a very interactive thing here. So whenever you want to say anything, shoot your hand up. Nothing? All right. Nobody wants candy, huh? It's melting on the computer right now, so first come, first serve. Okay. So how does this brain training stuff work? Raise your hand if you consider yourself to be an athlete. Okay, not a lot of hands. Somebody define athlete for me. What does it mean to be an athlete? Oh, guys, it's Snickers and stuff. Somebody say something. Yeah. Can't hear you. Take a guess. Say something. I know you want it.
When you compete and so.
Competing. Okay. Competing. It's coming at you. Ready? Everybody shield your eyes. I'm not making any promises. Hold your hands up. Oh, nailed it. Okay. Yes, what were you gonna say?
Team player,
okay. Coming at you. Good, you guys are gonna be excellent catchers by the end of this. Yes. To train for an organized sport. Interesting. You guys are all kind of thinking of a similar thing here. Can anybody think a little bit more outside the box? Yeah.
To practice to become proficient in something primarily physical.
It's definitely closer. Coming at you. Anybody else? A broader definition. Yes.
Being active.
Okay. Cool. I'm going to stop you there. We're going to have a little bit of a conversation about what it means to be an athlete. So if you're an athlete, Nice. If you're an athlete, you're getting paid to move. Can we all agree that at least at the basic level that that's true? If you're an athlete, you're getting paid to move. Okay, who doesn't move in their line of work? Do any of you not move in your jobs? What do?
I sell printers.
Okay, do you breathe?
Yeah.
Okay, so your diaphragm moves.
Okay.
And you're getting paid to move. If you couldn't move, you wouldn't be getting paid. Anybody else? No? So, okay, yeah? Oh, so do I most of the time. So that aside, that's like kind of like a sub part of the definition. But as a general rule, everybody is an athlete because you all need to move to be able to make money. If you're typing, that's a lot of finger mobility. And I'm sure you've heard of carpal tunnel, so we can talk about that later as well. If you are a librarian, that's a lot of shoulder flexion, putting the books up on the shelf. If you are a mom, nobody pays you, but you get paid love if you're a mom. But that's bending and squatting and picking up the kids. And so we are all athletes because we're all being paid to move. And if we can't move, we're not getting paid. Even at the most basic level, if you sit still all day long, but you're breathing, you're still moving. So if we can agree that we're all athletes, does anybody disagree? Just, I don't want you to disagree, but yeah.
I know people like doesn't move, we get paid.
Uh-huh. For what, sorry?
Like the models for you drawing, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Sit there until you know.
Mm-hmm. They still breathe though, so their diaphragms are moving.
Still moving.
Mm-hmm. Their noses move when they breathe. So if we're all athletes, I'm gonna take it one step further. And I'm gonna tell you that everything is a skill. So a skill is simply anything that can be learned or unlearned. So everything. Everything is a skill. The perfect jump shot for you back there, Miss Basketball Player, that's a skill. Hitting a high C, that's a skill. You know what else is a skill? Seeing, waking up, moving your neck, learning how to not be stressed, memory is a skill. Everything is a skill. So I just want to kind of recap what we've covered so far. So brain training, it's harnessing neuroplasticity to make a change. Everybody's an athlete, everything is a skill. In order to enhance a skill that we want to be better at or unlearn a skill that we don't want to be better at, we just need to work with our brains. Does anybody have any questions up until that point?
Where does the pay come in?
Where's pain?
Pay. Oh,
pay.
You get paid.
Oh, well, we'll talk outside. I'm paying you in candy.
No, you said, like, is anybody who's breathing and moving
mm-hmm. Oh, so what I was trying to illustrate is that mm-hmm, right. So what I was illustrating is that we are all athletes because an athlete is somebody who gets paid to move. If you are making a living or doing anything in your life right now, even we'll take the money out of it. Anything that you are doing, if you are a full-time student, you're still an athlete. And the reason that that's an important distinction to get across is because by the end of this lecture, I want you to consider yourself an athlete so that you train yourself like an athlete and so that you treat your body like an athlete and realize that it doesn't make sense for a basketball player to treat his or her body really, really, really extraordinarily well, but for a school teacher to not to. Does that make sense? Because we are all athletes at the same level. It's just some of us are sports athletes, and some of us are teacher athletes, and some of us are mom athletes and student athletes, but we're all athletes. So we should all care as much about training our body and our brain as the athletes that we see on TV. Does that clarify your question? Cool. All right, anybody else have any questions? Somebody ask something because I'm thirsty. By the way, nothing more awkward than drinking in front of a room full of people. Does that feel all the eyes? Yes.
Can I get you to review what you said earlier? You said brain training is harnessing, and I wonder.
Sure, I'll make sure I say it right then. So, brain training the brain is harnessing neuroplasticity to elicit a change. Those are my words, but it's all basically we're focusing on training the brain to elicit whatever it is that we want to change, the things we collected on the board over here. All right, sure. Are you all with me so far? Whoa, okay. Somebody stand up, because I don't think any of you are with me. Stand up, somebody stand up. Oh, guys. Thank you. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
See.
Yeah, better. See. Cool. So, if we're talking about everything, this is for you. If we're talking about everything's a skill, even with this letter ball game, do you see how almost everybody I've done this with, their first catch, they haven't said the letter while it's still in the air. By the second and third catch, they catch on because it's a skill. It's a really easy one, so she learns it really fast. But that's just kind of a little example of everything is a skill, and you can learn things really, really, really fast. They don't all have to be. I mean, some of these are long-term things, but anyway, just wanted to point that out. So, everyone's an athlete. Everything's a skill. I want to talk about something practical right now that you can all relate to. So talking about everything is a skill, I'm going to go as far as to say even your filter of what you bring to your attention, your conscious awareness is a skill. So if I could train freshman in college Cecilia, I would want to train her to be better at the skill of socializing and not being so kind of awkward at parties. So because everything is a skill, socializing is a skill. And so here's what I would tell freshman Cecilia, that's me by the way, if I could go back in time to my short stint in college before the Wizard of Oz thing happened. So in one second, your brain takes in approximately 40 billion signals. You have the ability to be aware of approximately 40 of them. So every second, the carpet underneath your feet, the wind on your arm, the rumbling in your stomach, your brain is getting all of these signals every second. And it has to choose what signals to bring to your conscious awareness. So we're talking about 40 out of 40 billion. So in order to understand how this works, who can tell me, is the brain wired for survival or performance? What do you think?
Survival.
Nailed it. You were the first. I saw it in your eyes. Good job. So the brain is wired for, yeah, you in the gray, yeah. The brain is wired for survival. Your brain's only job, it has one job, it's an important job. Your brain's only job is to keep you alive. And so your brain uses its filter to help keep you alive. So if the brain is wired for survival, and its job is to bring pertinent information to your attention, and in one day in our nervous system, we are receiving 6.8 petabytes of information. That's a 6.8 and then 17 zeros, for anybody who doesn't know what a petabyte is. Your brain is getting all this information, and it has to filter what of that information comes to your consciousness. So now, your filter is a skill, and that's why it's so important to me that you understand that everybody is an athlete. Literally everything is a skill. And so you can even train your own filter. And so how this reverts back to the party is, let's say I'm walking into this party, right? On a precognitive level, my filter is taking in all the signals, and how it chooses which ones to bring to my attention is that if the brain is wired for survival, it thrives on predictability. Because if your brain can predict what's going to happen, it can better keep you safe. And so it's in my brain's best interest that I get out of an experience what I want, or not want, that was a bad word, what I expect to get out of an experience. Is everybody with me so far? So I'm going into this party. There's two ways this can go. Same party. If I go into it expecting to be uncomfortable and have an awkward, bad time, it's within my brain's best interest, in the name of survival and predictability, to train that filter to pick out all of the negative cues. So my brain, I'm getting all of these signals. There's all of this information when I walk into this party, right? My brain is going to notice that the music is kind of crappy, and the lighting is kind of ugh, and the food is kind of ugh. And that's my brain trying to keep me alive. Did you like that description of the ugh? So if I go into this party and I think to myself, I'm going to really enjoy myself, well, my brain, of the 40 million signals per second that come into my brain, the ones that's going to filter to bring to my consciousness, it's going to be all of the positive stuff, the good vibes, the cool people, the just the nicer parts of the night. And so I don't know if you've ever, you're going to laugh, I don't know if you've ever heard of this whole thoughts become things, I don't know where that phrase came from, but we use it a lot. But it's true, thoughts become things. That's for you. So your brain, you can literally control that experience for yourself. I could have controlled, and I do now, I could have controlled my experience in that party just by training how my filter works, training myself to look for the positive instead of the negative. Anybody have any questions about that? Okay, cool. So all of you who want to change something about your life, everybody who shouted something that made it up onto the board, this is where it all starts, in the brain, with the filter. And where the empowerment comes in is in recognizing that if we have control over everything, even control over our own filter, then there's hope that we can achieve virtually any change that we want for ourselves if we harness the power of the nervous system. So how do we start? Well, I want to talk to you about how the brain works. Is everybody with me so far? Can somebody ask a question or something? Can I repeat what? The whole thing? I'm going to go back to page one. No. Okay, so if we have control over everything, we even have control over our own filter. So there's hope that we can achieve virtually any change that we want for ourselves if we harness the power of the nervous system. Okay, so before I move on, because now we're going to get into the, I don't think it's boring. I'm afraid you might think it's boring. We're going to get into how the brain works now, really briefly, and then there'll be just like a lot more candy. But before we do that, I just want somebody to give a really quick summary, one or two sentences of everything that we've covered so far, just so I can make sure that I'm doing a good job kind of getting this across. Anybody, give me a, yes?
Everybody's an athlete.
Everybody's an athlete. Everything's a skill.
Our filter is a skill.
Our filter is a skill. Something happened, something fell? No. For you, thank you for starting that off. Good, you guys are with me. So it's pretty basic stuff. I'm very much a movement person. It's very hard for me to, oh, it's me who's making all that noise. I apologize, I move less. It's very hard for me to just use words and not use movement. And so I want to make sure I'm doing a very good job kind of clarifying everything. So I'm going to use this brain diagram that none of you can read. And next time I will make a PowerPoint, because making PowerPoints is a skill and I can train that. I just didn't have enough notice. So you guys can come up later. I'll leave this up here and just snap a picture of it if you happen to want this. Or you can just not enjoy this at all and never want to look at it again. So here's your brain. This is very accurate, true to size drawing. Here's basically what you need to know. And you know what? I wasn't going to do this, but I'm going to read this quote. This is a quote that I love. So this is something that was said by Dr. Eric Cobb, who is the founder of ZHealth, which is the brain-based training company that I have all of my education from. And this is something he said that I liked a lot, so I'm going to sure read this to you. Everything you have ever felt or done in your life was due to brain function. At the most basic level, the intricate firing rates and patterns of your brain both determine who you have been and, more importantly, who you will become. All human change represents change in that individual's nervous system. All that we are is brain-derived. It's cool, right? So here's your brain. Basic feeding pattern of the brain. Should seem very obvious. I take a step. Where does that information go? Oh, my God. Look at my hands. I don't know what that's from. All of the information comes up bottom to top, back to front. So it comes up through the spinal cord. Every one of those 40 billion signals per second is coming up through the spinal cord, through the cerebellum, to the back of your brain, all the way to the front. Finally, where it lands in the frontal lobe, that's where we make all of our decisions. Frontal lobe. Who knows anything about the frontal lobe? In the blue. What do you need to name anything? Any fact?
Emotions.
So emotions actually lie in the back of the brain. The frontal lobe is, yeah?
Decisions.
Mm-hmm. Decisions, it's more, yeah?
Personality.
A little bit of both, yeah. So it's more of the concrete stuff in the frontal lobe. So our working memory, our inhibition, our judgment, our decisions, habits, and more of the primitive survival functions are in the back of the brain. But the front is really important, but hey, you're gonna get a Reese's cup anyway, so here you go. Ready? It's coming at you. Hands up. I am nailing throwing tonight, and I would love some just any sort of pat on the back later for that, because I'm not a thrower. I'm getting very good at catching from all the letter ball. Really impressed with my throwing tonight. So information, before it gets here, where you can do something with it, it has to pass through all of this stuff. So obviously, this is very simplified. There's quite a lot more in the back of your brain. But we're just going to talk about three really important sections. So we have the temporal lobe. That is where your auditory and vestibular system lives. So auditory and vestibular system, that's obviously hearing and balance. Anybody you know who has vertigo, balance issues, that's all dysfunction in the temporal lobe. We have the occipital lobe. That's vision. And just to clarify, vision and eyesight are two different things. So eyesight, for those of you who wear glasses, eyesight, that's the image that comes in through your lenses. Vision is your brain's interpretation of that image. So fun fact, we'll talk about it later. We're going to watch just in a second, actually, a really cool little YouTube clip about this. But you can train your vision. I've seen a lot of people do this vision training that we teach at Z-Health and kick glasses for good. You can even, and we're going to talk about this later, do vision drills if you are blind, if you have no eyesight at all. Because the vision drills is about strengthening your ocular muscles. And you can still move your eyes even if you can't see. So anyway, occipital lobe, that's vision. Parietal lobe, that's mapping. That's the kind of confusing one. So anybody know anything about proprioceptive mapping? I didn't really expect any hands to go up. Those are a lot of big words. I wrote it over there. It's a long word to write. So the parietal lobe, that's where your brain has its 3D movement awareness map. So that's how your brain knows where you are in space. So I like to just imagine a map tattooed onto my body. But instead of it being like the map of Arizona, it's a map of all of my landmarks. So shoulder, elbow, wrist, thumb. So just imagine that map all over your body. And now sometimes what happens is parts of that map in your brain will become blurry. So for example, if you break your elbow and you're in a cast for about 6 weeks, your brain's map of that part of your body is going to start to get really, really blurry because it's not getting any feedback there. It's been in the cast for 6 weeks. And so then you're going to take the cast off, and you're going to have to kind of relearn how to mobilize that. And that's what you're actually doing, is you're re-clarifying that map. So that's proprioception, is your brain's movement awareness map, how it knows where you are in space. We're going to talk about it later in depth, but that's just a quick little overview. So, and then the cerebellum, so the bottom, and that's where all the integration happens. That's where seeing well, moving well, balancing well all comes together and integrates and creates the beautiful humans that you are. So that's how the brain works, and why that's important to understand is because if before information gets here for me to do anything with it, it has to pass through all this stuff. If something here, here, or here isn't working 100% correctly, or something is firing that shouldn't be firing, or is underactive and we need to make it fire more, then you're not getting 100% accurate information with which to make decisions with. And that's when bad things happen to your body. So how I train, and I've got so excited about the car accident story, I don't think I told you, I'm a personal trainer. How I train my clients, my athletes, is not only do I do drills for proprioception, so movement drills, but I also do visual drills and vestibular system drills, because I want to make sure that everything is functioning optimally so that my athlete has 100% accurate information every time she makes or he makes a decision. Does anybody have any questions about that? Somebody stand up. We're going to train some vision. Now you know why it's really important. God, nobody wants to train their vision. I'm going to call on somebody, and no, that's unfortunate for everyone. So this guy, look at me. Yeah, ready? Mm-hmm. Track it all the way in. Yeah, good. You're very brave. She's not even flinching. She trusts me. Keep that. Yeah, good. Good. That's for you. So this is one of the drills that my favorite drills to do with my athletes is the letter ball, because it's a visual training drill. It's also a heck of a lot of fun and a good way to warm up. So I do that one a lot. So I want to, and so we're gonna see how this works here. I want to play you a little bit of a quick little YouTube clip I found very interesting about vision training, something that you guys can relate to because the Olympics are going on right now.
When the nurse at the Park City emergency room told me I had shattered my eye socket, it was intense. It was traumatic, and my vision was totally compromised. Basically, I was warming up for a double backflip. Right off the bat, I knew I had thrown it too hard.
She landed on her head, wrenched her neck in a horrible way, and then kneed herself in the face. I've seen Gretchen fall really hard. She always gets up. She couldn't get up this time.
I broke open my eyebrow, and I shattered my eye socket, and broke my nose, and gave myself a really bad concussion. I had completely blown to pieces my orbital floor. There were a lot of people who thought this was going to be a career-ending accident for me. My first time back into the half pipe, I dropped in and immediately knew that I shouldn't be in there. My uninjured eye was in one spot, and then my injured eye was kind of lower than that, so I was seeing two images at once. I was off balance, I had vertigo, I was dizzy. I couldn't snowboard with the vision I had.
Doctors literally told her that eye exercises wouldn't help, and she was not going to hear that.
That just didn't really make any sense to me. I've been a pro athlete for a very long time, and I feel like there's always a way to get better.
Okay, Gretchen, I need you to put your knee right over your hip. I had never come across anything like this, and definitely did not find a lot of situations to draw from to help me create the right path for her. She showed me the few eye exercises that she was doing, and it just didn't seem aggressive enough.
So we basically created this customized program that probably no one's ever done before. Brad said, okay, you've been doing these eye exercises by yourself, but you don't do them in motion. So we're going to add in the motion, squats, agility exercises, and plyometrics. We're gonna physically exert you while you're focusing on a point. This is definitely a crazy program that is very non-traditional. The exercises reenacted the speed you have to take in the half pipe combined with where you need to look.
Training to be like a top professional in the half pipe these days is so much different than it used to be. It's become so competitive. It's a 12-month job now. I mean, if you're not on the hill, you're in the gym, and that's just how it goes.
I push my athletes as hard as I feel that is safe. Gretchen is someone that I probably push harder than anybody.
That's ultimately why I was able to get back on a snowboard.
The injury really did reflect exactly who she was. She's focused and determined and competitive with herself.
And she has the strongest work ethic.
She's definitely not scared to push it.
I mean, she's back, you know. The first event we started working together was the U.S. Open in Vail, and she made the final. I mean, she did it, and it's crazy. I couldn't imagine doing that.
Next season is going to be intense. It's like a pressure cooker. There's 5 Olympic qualifiers, the Grand Prix, and they're back to back to back to back to back.
For Gretchen to medal at the Olympics, she's got to continue doing the things she's doing. You know, she's absolutely one of the top female riders out there.
She's done it all, so she knows what it takes.
I've been doing this for a long time, and this is probably going to be my last Olympic experience. I see the Olympics as this opportunity to get better, push harder, and do things you never thought you could do.
Thoughts on that? Anybody? Yes. Yeah, I was actually going to ask if anybody, I don't have a TV, so I was going to ask if anybody knew if that competition had happened yet, but it's tomorrow. Cool. So I hope you all watch it now with kind of a new perspective. So the kind of training that you saw them doing, it's how I train my athletes, combining proprioceptive movement, map clarity, movement drills, like she was doing, with visual drills. I have a bunch of eye charts all over my studio. And I'm always combining that kind of cognitive load of visual training with actual movement. And I've had some pretty remarkable results. But so any thoughts come up watching that video for anybody about vision training? Is vision training starting to make sense to you as why it's a valid thing? Or are you still, does it still kind of seem like this kind of ethereal, confusing thing? Because we're going to clarify it now, but yeah. Yeah.
And so the activeness helped with that? Or if she was, you know, if she was just standing still, it wouldn't have helped at all?
Well, yes and no. So she was doing two different things. She was trying to retrain her vision so that she could go through life not having double vision. She was actually also, though, doing sport-specific training. And so when you have that kind of a trauma, you have to train in a couple of different ways. And so just because she would be able to, let's say she trained her vision in a typical like optometrist's office, and she was able to get rid of the obvious vision issues for just like walking down the street and being able to see clearly, it doesn't necessarily mean that when she got back on the slopes, she wouldn't have sport-specific dysfunction. And so she was doing two different things. She was training in a sport-specific way, and I'm sure she also trained in just a regular rehab setting as well, just sitting down doing vision charts. And that's how I train as well. So, you know, I'll do vision charts, just standing in front of a vision chart, doing my vision drills. I'll also, if I'm having a problem with a movement, if I'm having a problem in a squat, a problem in a press, I'll also combine the vision drills with that sport-specific activity and just try and train in that way. Is that a confusing answer to a question?
No, it's not at all.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. We're gonna go to my next slide. I know this says, it doesn't matter, you can't read it. It says pain is an action signal, but we're going to pretend it doesn't say pain because we're not talking today about pain so much yet, unless anybody has any questions about pain later. I want to talk about the idea of dysfunction versus an action signal. And is there something actually wrong when we have what we'll call dysfunctions for now, and we're going to explain that a little bit more? Or is our brain just trying to get our attention? So I have this little diagram we call threat bucket. I want you to think of your body as a bucket of threat. Every day, just threat, threat, threat going into your body. The brain is wired for? Nicely done. So the brain's only job is to protect you, which means that if the brain feels like you are in imminent danger, it's going to have to give you some sort of a signal, because your brain, in an effort to protect you, is going to want you to make a change. And so we have pain, fatigue, anger issues, motor issues, startle, immune system stuff, endocrine stuff. These are the things that people usually want to change. The difference between a traditional approach and a brain training approach is, let's say somebody comes to me in pain. Well, I'm not going to treat the pain like a traditional physical therapist or trainer would. I'm going to try and figure out what the brain is feeling threatened by that's causing it to give you that action signal of pain, and I'm going to train the threat. So imagine every day we have all this threat coming into our system. We have bad eyes, bad balance, SMA, that's all this stuff here. We also have job stress, financial stress, environmental stress, relationship stuff, poor diet, anything you can think of that your brain would find threatening to your happiness and survival. We have all this stuff coming into our buckets every day. And eventually, if you have enough threat in your life, it's going to rise. Well, if we're going with this bucket analogy here, the water level is going to rise to a place where it's got to come out. And that's where you get the outputs. And we're calling pain, fatigue, all that stuff outputs. And so instead of somebody, an athlete comes to me, they have frozen shoulder. Instead of trying to treat the tissue at the shoulder, I'm going to figure out why is the brain feeling threatened and why is the brain giving you an action signal of frozen shoulder. So if we're just to kind of clarify this example, let's say we'll keep with the pain scenario here. So let's say somebody is feeling pain. So pain does not necessarily correlate to tissue damage. It does some of the time in acute instances, and in chronic pain it sure doesn't. I know for me, my knee surgery was 6 years ago and I still have pain. There's no damage there, but I still have pain because my brain is still feeling threatened. And so if I'm going to inoculate that threat and I'm trying to figure out, well, okay, this person's got chronic low back pain, what could possibly be threatening them so consistently that the brain feels a need to get his or her attention by giving him or her that chronic low back pain? So let's say we figure out she hates her job. She goes to this job every day. Her boss treats her terribly. She's not getting paid a lot. She's working really, really hard. She's very unhappy there. So from a survival perspective, that's not a really good idea for her to keep going to that job. And so if her brain needs to get her attention, what is the fastest, easiest way to prevent her from going to work? Give her so much pain that she can't get out of bed and can't go to work. And so in cases like that, where I'm successful in eliminating pain is not by working on the lumbar spine. It's by inoculating that threat, figuring out how to take care of that job situation so that her brain is no longer trying to get her attention, and then the back pain just magically goes away. So I want you to start thinking about dysfunction as action signals and think about how, again, if I have bad eyes, could that be really, really scary to my brain? If there are parts of my vision, if I have no right-sided peripheral vision, from a neurological standpoint, could that be terrifying to my brain that there's stuff happening over here that I can't see? And might my brain want to give me some sort of a signal, maybe chronic fatigue, maybe I have really, really hard time reading and writing? And so let's actually stick with this board over here because this is your stuff. So somebody who has a hard time reading and writing, I can almost guarantee you there's a visual drill that can help you with that. Somebody has neck pain, again, I wouldn't necessarily, unless it's acute, if it's chronic pain, I wouldn't necessarily go directly to the neck. I would think, ooh, maybe she's got some vestibular thing going on. And that's really scary because vestibular system is balance, and if you can't balance, you can't move. So maybe I'll find a vestibular system drill that suddenly makes that pain go away. Memory, also short-term memory, that's usually also a visual thing. So I just want you guys to start seeing that instead of trying to directly make a change with these things that we have on the board over there, you might want to think about, well, what threat could I inoculate that would help me make those changes? Does that make sense? Yeah? Yeah? Excellent. Yes, I love questions. Mm-hmm. So I think I've thrown this word around a little bit, a threat inoculation. So think about a vaccine. A vaccine is it's an inoculation, so giving you a little bit of the virus so that your body kind of gets used to it, feels a little bit safer with it, and then hopefully it prevents you from getting that virus going forward. So threat inoculation is kind of like that. And so, I mean, it would be a very individual-specific piece of advice, and that's a very general topic, but let's say somebody came to me with an emotional sort of change that they wanted to make, I would figure out how can I make that as least threatening as possible. Because change in itself is incredibly threatening, because if the brain is wired for survival, it thrives on predictability. And change stands in the way of predictability. So even, you know, we wonder why is it so hard to stick to a weight loss plan, right? When we know that it's the healthy thing for us, we know it's the right thing to do, But change, good or bad, is incredibly neurologically threatening. And so your brain will do anything it can to stand in the way of you making a change, even if you know logically that change is really, really good for you. Change is still very, very threatening because it disrupts predictability. And so when we're dealing with any sort of an emotional sort of threat, we just want to make it as small as possible. Does that kind of answer your question? We can talk afterward on a bit more specific, basic, because it's kind of hard to give such vague advice. But anybody else have any questions? Yeah.
How about nerve damage?
Nerve damage. Ah, it's my favorite topic. I've got it all over me. So what kind of nerve damage?
Let's say I had a dog bite mm-hmm. in my hand, and it punctured all the nerves.
Mm-hmm. So, well, we would do a couple of things with that. First of all, we would do proprioception enhancement. So we would do a lot of joint mobility. That's something we're going to talk about later. I keep referring to this thing that you can't see. We would try and clarify your brain's map of, what is it, your hand? Mm-hmm, of the hand, just so that your brain gets a little bit more information. We would also do visual drills. So I would try and find out if you could remember which way your eyes were looking when that attack happened. I would put you back in that eye position, have you do drills while you were in that eye position to try and just reduce the threat a little bit more. We would do nerve glides, so that's kind of flossing the nerve. I would actually play with the nerves themselves. But I would also try to just, again, it's all about reducing threat. So there's a big fear component when we've had a traumatic experience like that. And so you want to just make the brain feel safe in any way that you can. And so we have very sneaky ways of making the brain feel safe with certain kind of vision drills, certain kind of vestibular system drills, and certain movement drills. Again, super general answer. For specific cases, it's so individual based. It's very, very hard to kind of, because it's brain training. It's, everybody's brain is so wildly different. So that's when it gets really challenging to answer questions like that, because literally I would handle each specific person completely differently. But the very basic fact is we want to reduce threat. That's all we want to do. It's not a very satisfying answer, but we can also talk later. You first, yeah? Yeah.
For your system.
Yeah.
So my husband's immunocompromised.
Okay.
So how would your brain, I guess, change for that specific issue?
How would the brain change?
How would your immune system mm-hmm. come into the whole play of brain training?
So this is a bit more of an in-depth kind of thing that, well, basically, the brain runs on fuel and activation. Tonight I've been mostly speaking about activation. Fuel is oxygen and glucose, basically. So part of one of the things I have here in the threat bucket is poor diet. And so there's obviously, when you have a surgical component, it's a little bit more complicated. But a lot of people, so this wouldn't apply to your husband, but a lot of people have autoimmune symptoms and diseases simply as a result of their nutrition. So if their brain finds their, let's say they have a very inflammatory diet, that's a very threatening thing to your brain. And so by inoculating the threat of the inflammatory diet, I can usually quiet the output of the immune system stuff. I did it to myself. I had lupus for 2 years, and I changed my diet, and I magically didn't have lupus anymore. So in your husband's case, it's a little bit more complicated because we have a fuel issue. So potentially I would do, first of all, a ton of breathing drills because oxygen, just the way that we breathe, plays a really, really, really big role in our overall health. So I would do mostly focused on fuel with his training. So I would do a ton of breathing drills. I would look at his diet, see if it's inflammatory or anti-inflammatory. But because there's also the added threat of he's undergone surgical, he's at the very least had a very long needle stuck into his body. So I would have to deal with the neural threat of that. I would probably do some scar tissue work. Scars are very neurally active. This is all, again, getting into kind of an individualized scenario. But there's just so much that we can, I would want to retrain how the brain viewed that situation that day of the bone marrow transplant or?
Yeah.
Yep. So again, I mean, I love coffee dates, so I'm happy anybody who has like an individual case who wants to go to coffee, we talk about it. But for now, that's kind of the basics. And then somebody back here? Yes? Okay.
I shouldn't even
Mm-hmm. It goes away.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then it will come back.
Me too. When I sing, all my pain goes away too. Mm-hmm. Music is a form of disassociation, and that's a mental toughness tool that we teach. So, I mean, when we're training the brain here, I mean, it's not just physical. There's so much. We can train mental toughness just like we can train physical toughness. We can train fuel just like we can train activation. And so there are thousands of drills. There are thousands of drills that we can do to get rid of your pain. It's a matter of which one makes the most sense for you. So if you have a background in music like I do, you already have that tool. You already know that tool is there for you. So now how can we take that, create a drill out of it, make it a rehab drill, and then use it to retrain the way your brain perceives your pain? So again, super individualized, but that's really cool. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. Sorry.
Sure.
Is this similar to the way you talk about the vision training? Is this similar to EMDR?
Yeah. So there's an amazing book, Tom, you read it, called Brain Spotting. I have all of my clients read this book. I definitely, definitely, definitely recommend it. And yeah, it's all, so it's not, I'm not certified in EMDR. I do very, very simple vision training. But buy this book, Brain Spotting. It's an incredible, incredible book. And I'm actually going to share with you, a really quick story, something really cool that happened to me in a session a little while ago. So basically the book Brain Spotting talks about how pain and traumatic events can get locked into certain parts of your visual field. And sometimes, oh, bummer. Bye, dude. Okay. sometimes when we are, if I run into a roadblock with a client and I can't get them out of pain, I'll do whoever I was talking about the dog bite with. I'll do that thing where I say, well, where were you looking when this happened? Okay, great. Hold your eyes down to the right. Now let's do some drills. Because our visual field is really, really tied in to where we hold our traumatic events. So actually for me, so I have two stories. For me, so one of the really easy basic drills that I'll have everybody do right now, so kind of sit up to the edge of your chairs, we're going to do eye circles. So you're going to hold your head nice and still, put your finger out in front of you, and you're just going to, just with your eyes, so don't move your head, just follow your finger in a circle. And what I want you to feel is, are there any parts of the circle that are really hard for you to put your eyes? Do your eyes kind of skip any parts of the circle? Keep doing it. Well, make sure you're keeping your head really still. Whoa, slow down. Go nice and slow so you can't cheat. Good. So I can actually see your eyes don't want to go up. That's pretty cool. Anybody? Okay, that's fine. That's plenty. Raise your hand if you felt a part of the circle where your eyes kind of twitched or something. Yeah, cool. So my pain is all neurogenic based. It's excruciating. and I was working with a coach about a year ago. He's the one who gave me Brain Spotting. He said, okay, I'm going to do an eye circle with you. So do the eye circle. And I mean, with me, it's hilariously dramatic. My eyes do not want to go up and to the right. They just don't want to go there. They will twitch and they will tear. He's like, well, clearly something's happened when you were looking up to the right. And we got to that spot, and I remembered that that's where I was looking. So I was looking up and to the right. Ooh, see, I can't even do it now. When my accident happened. And so that trauma of that accident was really, really locked into that visual field for me. And so ever since then, we've been very, ever so slowly and gingerly processing that experience using a lot of up and right training. So I had this really cool experience. This was up and left. So I had this really cool experience just last week with a brand new client. And I was going through my initial ocular evaluations and did the circle. And he could not get his eyes to go to the corner, to the left. I think his was up and left. Mine's up and right. Could not, I mean, violently, almost as violently as mine, they would not go up there. So he would track, and then he would get to the corner and go, and then he would come back in and get to the corner and go like this. And so I said to him, I said, what is that making you feel right now, going into that up and left position? And he said, World Trade Center. And I said, go on. And he locked his eyes in that position, and proceeded for about 15 minutes to tell me the story. Apparently, he was living in New Jersey at the time of September 11th, and he was a first responder. So he was sitting in a cafe, and he was looking. He was drinking coffee, reading the paper. He was looking out the window. He was looking up and to the left out of the corner of his eye, and he said, "Hey, that plane's flying really low." And he watched the plane fly into the tower. And then not only did he have that up and left experience, but he ran out of the restaurant, started running to go, because he was an EMT. And as he's running the whole way, I mean, it was obviously a really long run, because, you know, So as he's running, he's looking up and left the whole time, tracking the other plane as it goes into the building. And so the whole time he's running down the street, he's always looking up and to the left, and all of those memories, those visceral memories that he has of that day, are all stuck in that part of his vision field. And so he's got a lot of other injuries and a very limited range of motion. So I was testing his shoulder flexion. So I said, "Okay, let's see your shoulder flexion." It's about to here. So I said, about here. I said, "Okay, let's do a couple of vision drills." We did some stuff up and to the left, all the way back, because that was so threatening. That position is so threatening to his brain that just by training it a little bit and reducing a little bit of that threat of that visual position gave him a lot of freed up range of motion. So anyway, that was a sidebar story, but I don't know if you found that useful or not, but vision training is very cool. Purchase brain spotting. We'll leave it at that. Any other questions? Yes.
Mm-hmm. And even though I don't take medicine for it, I can't even cope with it, but I still get physical panic attacks.
Okay.
You know, like being at home, being comfortable, not feeling anxious or stressed at all. Do you think that I can train my brain out of thinking that I'm in a stressful environment even if I don't feel stressed?
I absolutely do. You know what? Why don't we... Yeah, we're going to skip ahead, and you're going to be my partner for this demo. So before I call you up, this is exactly what this is for. So this is really cool. We're going to do a little bit of practical vision training. Who can tell me anything about peripheral vision? I'm going to break the candy out again. I know. We've been talking for like an hour here. You guys are doing so good. Peripheral vision. Anybody? Yes?
Like what you see out of the corner.
Yes, ma'am. Everything you see that you're not looking at. Who knows what tunnel vision is? Somebody who doesn't have candy yet. Yes. Yeah, that's a very good depth. Did everybody hear that? No? Okay, so tunnel vision, arms up, duck. Good. Tunnel vision is when your peripheral vision goes away, basically. It's a fight or flight response. Basically, your brain is wired for?
Survival.
Bravo. So your brain is feeling like you are under imminent threat. And so it narrows your vision, it's an action signal, so that you're forced to focus on what is really threatening you right now in this moment. So tunnel vision is something that should be a fight or flight response. It should only be there if somebody's pointing a gun at you, or if you're about to get into a car accident. But a lot of us have vision problems. Everybody in this room, let's just go ahead and say, has a vision problem. So I have yet to meet a client of mine who hasn't needed to train their vision in some way. One of the really common things that people have going on is kind of an all-of-the-time sort of tunnel vision. So we should have quite a lot, and I can even kind of feel mine's kind of narrowed right now because I'm a little nervous. We should have quite a lot of peripheral vision. And a lot of times, sometimes people will have like none on one side, or they'll have just a generally kind of narrow vision. And so if we're trying to make the brain feel really safe and unthreatened, a very easy and fun way to do that is to just force yourself to open up your peripheral vision. Just try and see a little bit more of what you're not looking at. Because remember, if the brain wants to keep you alive, the more you can see, the safer it's going to feel. And so sometimes training is as simple as, well, let me open up your peripheral awareness, and oh, your shoulder pain went away. So it's really, peripheral vision is super tied into anxiety because obviously tunnel vision is a fight or flight response. So why don't you come up here? I'm going to show you how we train a little peripheral vision drill. This is a little, I hope you like to dance. This is a lot of fun. So
I can see why you're nervous.
Yeah, it's horrible, right? Right now you're probably in such tunnel vision.
All you.
It's all me. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to stand like this. You're going to put your hand right here. Okay. Other hand too.
Okay.
They'll never touch.
Okay.
You're going to look at my nose the whole time.
Okay.
And you're just going to match anywhere that I go. So if I come out here, good. And so the point is, she's trying now to see what my hands are doing without actually looking at them. And just this drill alone, yeah, you broke it. Good job. Just this drill alone right now is bringing more awareness to her peripheral, yeah, vision. It's really hard to talk and do this at the same time, huh?
I'm distracting you.
So basically, I would do this probably for about 5 minutes. We're not going to do it for 5 minutes.
Okay, I understand.
I'm very bored. Although I could give them some candy, which would hold them over for a little bit longer. But so I would do this for a while. I would even start to involve lunges and feet and see. And over time, very good job.
Here,
thank you. starting to melt because it's been on the computer. But
thank you.
Go nuts. So do that drill a lot with people. Over time, and it's funny because even we only did it for a couple of seconds, everything's a little bit brighter now. You don't believe me. Everybody stand up, turn to a partner. This is good. Yeah, you're going to enjoy this. Stand up, turn to a partner. And I want you all to do that drill for about 2 minutes, and you're going to be my partner.
I have no peripheral vision.
That's okay. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do a different kind of drill with you. Okay. I'm going to stand right behind you. I'm going to squeeze in here. Whoops, sorry, guys. And I want you to say okay every time you see one of my hands.
Okay.
Good.
Okay. 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 Yep. Okay. 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 Okay.
Good. So now, do you feel like looking around the room now? Your vision's any kind of brighter? Even just a little bit? We only did it for a minute.
Yeah.
Cool. So imagine we did it for 5 minutes. Cool. Everybody sit down. Good job. So you all just reduced a little bit of neurological threat. I hope you're feeling much safer now. Raise your hand if your vision just feels a little bit clearer or a little bit brighter now. Cool, a couple of you, and we literally only did that for like 15 seconds. If I was in my studio right now, we'd be doing that for about 5 minutes. But it's just paying attention. So I'm gonna tell you a secret. Best training cue ever, whether you are working out or taking a walk or at the grocery store, the best cue you can give yourself is pay attention. And it sounds really silly. I was telling somebody back there, read this book called Spark. It's an amazing book by John J. Rady, I believe. It's called Spark. That's all I know. but it talks about just the act of paying attention reduces threat. Just the act of paying attention to your vision improves your vision. The act of paying attention to your movement improves your movement. And so just by paying attention to your eyes for 20 seconds, most of you are seeing clearer. And so that's really cool because what I hope that you leave here today understanding is that this isn't hard and it doesn't take very long. All you have to do is pay attention, figure out what your brain is feeling threatened by, spend a couple of minutes a day on it, and man, the changes are just so dramatic. So, all right, yes, anybody have any questions? Yeah.
So if somebody is on medication, whether it be pain medication, mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So you're asking how I coach my individual clients? Because right now I'm not so much talking about me as a personal coach. I'm talking about just kind of brain training in general. And you can train your brain if you're on medication, if you're off medication, if you have a doctor, if you don't have a doctor. Anybody can do this dancing drill. It's just go to a bar and say, hey, sir, do this with me. It's a really good icebreaker. I've made a lot of friends that way. But if you're asking how I would handle it with my personal client, again, it's on a case-by-case basis. I do always try and have relationships with my clients' doctors, but I, you know, there's I'm not qualified to say get off your medication or stay on your medication. That's not a part of what I do. I try and make my clients better at what they want to be better at. And so if they want to be better at functioning on their painkillers, I will help them be better at functioning on their painkillers. If they want to be better at functioning off their painkillers, I will do that too. It's not my place to make suggestions like that, but if somebody comes to me and they want help with getting off medication, I will 100% do that. You just have to be careful when you're in my position with diagnosing and with making professional recommendations and that kind of stuff. Does that kind of answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
So then how would the brain training relate to your specific CRPS issue with the nerve damage? Because that's completely like, that is a neurological issue also.
Yeah.
How does that relate to helping you?
So from my own experience, I have been working on changing my relationship with pain. The biggest pain relieving tool that I use with myself and then with my chronic pain clients. So anybody who has a very severe long-term issue that isn't as easy as fixing a frozen shoulder, the best tool for that is education. Because if you understand what's happening and why you're in pain and how everything works, it makes the pain different. That's the only way I can really describe it. I mean, for me, to understand the threat bucket and to understand, because it's very confusing for somebody who, there's nothing wrong. This, you know, a nerve was cut 6 years ago. It's 2014, there's nothing wrong inside of me. Why do I still have pain? So for somebody who's in that kind of a situation to learn about the brain, I mean, with every course I take, and this is gonna sound cheesy, with every course I take, my pain level shrinks. Because the more I understand and the more it makes sense to me, your relationship with pain just changes. So on the one hand, I have dramatically reduced my actual physical pain. I mean, I couldn't walk for a while. Now, what was crippling, total body, nightmarish pain, it's all kind of located now in my right knee. So I still have a lot of pain in my right knee, and I'm still working toward a solution to that. And, you know, I haven't really found the magic bullet to make that go away yet. But, oh, I mean, it went from basically not being able to function and not being able to bathe or feed myself to now it hurts when I touch my knee. So I can handle that. So I've done a lot of appropriate parietal mapping drills, a lot of visual and vestibular system drills to reduce the threat of the eye issues, the balance issues, and then just, you know, I was in full leg casts, and so you can imagine all the sensory motor amnesia I had. My maps were so blurry. So I did all of that stuff, got to a really great place where I am now, where I am fully, fully functioning. I have some really, really annoying pain in my right knee, but it is what it is. And now where I'm at, I've come a really long way using actual mobility drills. Now it's just a matter of education. And just like we said, the filter is a skill. So it's a matter of, I can retrain, and I hope to see you a year from now and tell you that this was successful, but to retrain the way my brain perceives pain. So everything is a skill. I am an athlete. Everything is a skill. Everything can be learned or unlearned. And so I haven't quite hacked the code yet on how to figure out the nerve pain in my knee. But I know that there's a skill somewhere in there that I can train, and eventually that's going to go away. Does that kind of answer your question? Yes.
I'm just going to touch on a couple of things that that you said.
For sure.
Eckhart Tolle talks about how guilt and shame come from living in the past, and anxiety and worry come from being in the future. Mm-hmm. Stress comes from existing, what's happening now in the present.
Okay.
Any change is usually overcoming a fear. Fear is, it's all fear-based.
Have you heard the quote, all of life is fear management?
Pretty much. Mm-hmm. And then the Buddha says, what you think you become, not that I'm Buddhist or anything like that. Mm-hmm. But I deal a lot with people with addiction, where we go back to the midbrain, amygdala and all that, and where it becomes part of the, it goes above on the top line of survival, eating, procreating, drinking, staying warm, and all that sort of thing. to where the frontal lobe has no ability to reason and stop that type mm-hmm. of an impulse. So
yep.
That seems to be, you know, you can mitigate like even MS or things that are, you know, definite physiological problems, but that seems to be the toughest thing that I see is something that's made it to the midbrain, and you, regardless of how we rationalize it or practice it or look at it,
mm-hmm.
outcome, when you have, when your midbrain goes
yeah.
past any ability of mm-hmm. the frontal cortex to stop it.
Yeah. So I think I understand what you're saying, and I want to, first of all, kind of reiterate so everybody can hear, and I want to try and kind of give you my version of a solution to what I think you're touching on. So the front part of our brain is what we're calling the new brain, and stop me if we're disagreeing at any point. The back part of the brain, that's what we call the old brain. So the old brain is where our habits and our primitive survival-based needs live. And the front brain is our more kind of rational decision making. So your brain weighs 3 to 5 pounds, and yet it takes up 25% of your total energy supply. So we're just going to talk really briefly, kind of do a sidebar here about energy supply and demand system in the brain. So the brain is a total energy hog, which makes sense because it's our central processing unit. And it's, you know, constantly just trying to keep us alive, which, thanks, brain. So the new brain is not at all energy efficient, whereas the old brain very much is. And that should make sense to you if you can see how habits, they don't take a lot of thinking, right? So they're very energy efficient, because if you have a habit, it just kind of kicks in, you don't have to think about it much. However, everything that happens in the new brain, there's a lot of energy expenditure that happens there to think and to rationalize and to, you know, go through stuff like that. And so what happens to a lot of people, if we're going to talk about willpower or trying to change a habit, is that, let's do a really practical example. Somebody wants to eat healthier. So that person, let's say, will spend all day long thinking about, oh God, I gotta make a healthy choice for dinner. And what happens and how this turns into self-sabotage is they will use up the limited amount of supply of energy that we have on a daily basis for our new brain. They will use it up with the worrying and the rationalizing and the thinking, so that by the time they get home and it's dinner time, there is literally no energy left in the new brain. And what happens then is we're forced to revert to using the old brain, which is habits. And then, you know, that's when they make their bad decision. But what they don't realize is the reason they made their bad decision is because they physically used up the entire energy supply for the new brain. And then the habit brain, the old brain, kicks in. And so if their habits are poor, that's what they're having for dinner. Does that make sense? And is that kind of what you're talking about? How you can self-sabotage by using up all of the rational energy in the new brain and force yourself to kick back and have to recruit that old brain. Is that kind of where you're at?
For the most part, I'm just saying that, are you willing to concede that there are some things that I mean, when your midbrain overrides your frontal cortex and there is no way that it, no matter how you spend that energy,
mm-hmm.
it's a survival instinct. It
mm-hmm.
becomes one of your survival instincts. And with addiction, for example, that's
mm-hmm.
the toughest one I deal with.
Okay.
You know, or not personally, but, you know.
Yeah, with your clients. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it takes a lot of work to get that out of the survival, out of the old.
It does take a lot of work. It is possible.
Oh, yeah.
Right, and that's the really important part, is this is not easy. And can everybody hear, by the way, if somebody's speaking, can everybody hear what they're saying?
Yeah.
Good. I just wanted to make sure this wasn't falling on deaf ears. So, so it's really hard. Because, I mean, habits, if you've had 30, 40 years of a habit, this is not going to change overnight. But it is possible, because everything is a skill, and so we can train that. It takes a lot of work, but it is trainable. Is that kind of, we're on the same page?
Definitely on the same page.
Cool. Does anybody have any other questions? Cool. Somebody stand up, catch a letter ball. Oh, you have a question, yes. Oh, good. You can stand up, ask your question, and then I'll prize you a letter ball.
Okay. I just am thinking things like repression mm-hmm. and amnesia would be your enemies, because we don't know we're repressed.
Mm-hmm.
Delusion. We don't know that we're deluded.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the nature of delusion. And I think that those things would get in the way and make it harder.
Yeah, it for sure. A lot of times, visual tools will really help with that, like what I was talking about, brain spotting. So sometimes you can distract the brain or put your brain in a position where stuff just comes out. On a lesser scale, a fun thing that I'll do for, should work on my vision. A fun thing that I'll do for my clients who, so I'm always analyzing gait when I'm doing joint mobility, and I have a lot of pain clients. So when I get the men, they do this thing where they don't want to admit that they're in pain, which is really silly because they've just had their ACL exploded. But they just have decided that they're men and they don't want to show pain. And so they'll give me, when I want to assess their gait, right? So I'm looking for SI function. So they'll give me performance walk. So they'll be in agony, but they don't want me to see their limbs. So they'll give me performance walk. And so what I'll do is I will give them, we call this dual tasking. I'll give them a cognitive task to do while they're walking. So I'll say, count backwards from 100 by sevens. And so they'll be like, 100, 93. 80 something, and so you know you can't hide it. So that's a fun thing that I'll do to, you know, if people are repressing or not wanting to show what's really going on and how their body moves, I'll do dual tasking. But if it's more of an emotional repression, I'll usually do visual. I've had extraordinary results with that. I have a lot of clients who've had car accidents, and usually the vision drills are really really good for getting them to tell that story. Position specific, so like, you know, a lot of times I'll have, if I'm not getting a lot out of somebody standing up, I'll lie them down, I'll put them in different positions. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff you can do. It does make it a lot harder. Ready? Hands up.
C.
Nice.
Woo. Z or two, whatever it was.
It's whatever you want it to be. Woo. Look at that. Saved your life. Good. This is for you.
C.
Nicely done. Okay. So, I want to kind of now move away from the me talking at you and do a little bit of me showing you. So we're going to talk about, I'm going to demo a couple of drills for you because I am a personal trainer and this should be a little bit movement oriented. So the drills that I do, so we've talked a lot about the visual drills. We've talked a little bit about vestibular system drills. My warm-ups look a little different than what you've probably seen in a gym. Everything I do is joint-based. So there's a place for stretching. I stretch too, and you know, I do all the traditional stuff, but I like to mobilize all of my joints before and after a workout or a lecture. I mean, I was in the bathroom doing like ankle tilts over there an hour ago. So the reason that we do joint mobility is because if we want to go back to this picture that none of you can see, we want to clarify our parietal lobe. We want to clarify our proprioceptive maps. So here's how that happens. We have nerve endings all over our bodies. We're going to talk about mechanoreceptors. They are the nerve endings that sense touch and movement and sound. So the fastest route, these are some big words, I'm going to say them very slowly so I don't get tongue-tied. The fastest route to proprioceptive enhancement, so that's map clarity, is to recruit as many mechanoreceptors as possible. Because the mechanoreceptive nerve endings, that's where your brain gets all that information to clarify those maps. So if the fastest route to proprioceptive enhancement is by recruiting as many mechanoreceptors as possible, and where do most mechanoreceptors live? In the joints. Where do we have most of our joints? In our hands and feet. So my warm-ups always start with hand and feet mobilization, just because I want to give the brain as much information about where I am in space as possible. And so we start there, and then we just mobilize all of the joints, because the more joints we're mobilizing, the more mechanoreceptive information we're getting, the clearer the map, that tattooed map on my body is. And I will specifically focus on areas of SMA, which is that sensory motor amnesia. So if anybody's been in the cast for a while, we're doing a lot of elbow circles. A lot of people have SMA in their lumbar spines, if they have desk jobs or students who sit a lot. So we'll do a lot of lumbar mobility. So I just want to kind of do some drills for you guys and show you what it looks like. So I need a volunteer.
I will for lumbar mobility.
For lumbar mobility. You know what? Lumbar mobility is a really tough one to do. So I'm going to stick with a little bit of easier ones. You can still be my demo, though. Yeah, so come on out. We might do lumbar. I didn't wear the right like pants for doing lumbar stuff. So okay, so we want to have an assessment, right? Because change. Where are we on time? Oh, we're good. change happens at the rate of the nervous system. So, like I said before, there are thousands of drills. Some drills are going to help. What's your name?
Chris.
Chris. Some are not. So I have to have a way of keeping track of what drills are giving him a positive assessment and what drills are we're not going to waste our time with. So we always have to have an assessment. So I usually assess gait. For this, I think we'll do a range of motion just so that you can see. So I'm going to have you show them your forward bend. So see how far down you can comfortably bend. Good. Come up and do it a couple more times just to make sure you're warmed up. Nice shoes, by the way. One more. I'm not a heels person. I put heels on to leave the house. I thought I'll be professional. I didn't make it out the door. Good. So we're about consistently fingertips on the ground. So we're going to try a couple of drills with Chris, and we're going to see if we can find a joint that by mobilizing decreases a little bit of neural threat in his parietal lobe and gives him a high payoff of more movement, of more flexibility. So we're going to try, and I'm actually, you can keep the toms on because, pop them off because we want your feet to get feedback from the floor. Pop them off. Yeah, now you're regretting this hard. All right, so we're going to start with ankle tilts. They're really, really easy. We're going to target a joint right here in his ankle. So I'm going to show you what the drill looks like, and then I'm going to actually get down, and I'm going to give you some sensory input. This is really important. So the sensory cortex comes before the motor cortex. So if you're exercising, right, a really, really good way to get a little bit more out of your exercise that you're working on is to give your brain a little bit of sensory information, so like skin, before you do it. So let's say you're doing a bicep curl. I promise you, this is really cool. Next time you're in a gym, if anybody's going to the gym, and I don't know. So let's say you're doing bicep curls. Skin stim your bicep before you do the curl, you will notice a huge difference because you're paying attention more. You're giving more information to your brain. So that just is to say that I'm going to show him what this drill looks like. I'm going to actually skin stim that joint on his ankle that I want to open, and we're going to see what happens. So this is a really easy one, not like the lumbar circle. So all it is just a little bit of a tilting. So don't do it yet. So all I'm doing is I'm trying to open and close that joint in my ankle. So I'm going to have you face them. Come stand right in the middle. Good. Hands out of the pocket, standing nice and tall. Bring one foot forward. Okay, I want you to stand really, really tall, so look straight ahead. And I want you to relax your breathing as much as possible. Hold on, not yet. I'm going to tell your brain this is where we're focusing right now. And look straight ahead, stand really, really tall. And can you feel where I'm rubbing? Good. I want you to tilt into where I'm rubbing. Good. I'm just going to feel for opening. Go right back to neutral. Do it a bunch of times. Good. And that's opening really nicely, so I want you to keep doing that.
So through neuroplasticity, you're just retraining your muscles your brain to teach your muscles different things?
Not quite with this one, so let's finish the drill and I'll re-clarify, but just look straight ahead for me because if your posture, this is another cool thing, if your posture is crappy, you're not going to get, no, you're what?
That's why I wanted, the lumbar
this
support.
This is great. It's a beautiful posture. But if you're compressing here, cerebellum is right here, right, at the base of the neck. So if you're compressing that cerebellum, that's where integration happens. The drill is useless without the cerebellum. So tall spine is a really, really important precursor drill to any drill that you do because you need your cerebellum to have a nice amount of space. So I'm going to have you just face one more time. What I'm going to do is we're going to do three of those ankle tilts in a row at a really nice slow pace with a really tall spine. And then you're going to just kind of bounce on your heels a little bit and then reassess your forward bend. Okay? So bring one foot forward. Good. And go ahead and open up. One, two, and three. Kind of bounce on your heels a little bit. Just bounce like this. Just give your brain a chance to just kind of input that information. Good. Nice and tall spine. And I want you to roll down and reassess. See if you get any farther. You got palms to the floor. Whew, that's a load off, because sometimes these demos don't go very well, so that makes me feel, thank you. I will accept that applause. It was probably directed at him, but I will take it. So you have a lumbar spine issue. However, that's not to say that doing ankle drills won't make that go away. Because remember, there's no direct correlation between tissue damage and harm and pain. It is just so unfortunately, confusingly random. That you could, the cool part of that is that you can address a threat anywhere and have a change anywhere So I could jam your thumb and make your deltoid not work. I can jam your cuboid and make your butt not work. I mean, it's literally, it's, and we can do that one. That one's fun to do. But so all we did was we just opened up a joint in your ankle and you increased your range of motion by about like 6 inches. So that's really cool. So to clarify, because your question was, how is this neuroplasticity? And this is kind of more functional based, what we're doing. It's all neuroplasticity because we're changing the maps in your brain. But specifically, what we did just there was we recruited more mechanoreceptors. First of all, we took his shoes off, so he got more information from the floor, from the nerve endings in the floor. The nerve endings in his feet that felt the floor under his feet. And we opened it, we mobilized the joint. And the arthrokinetic reflex states that jammed joints create weakness and inflexibility, and open joints create strength and flexibility. And so we opened one joint, and he accomplished what most people will sit on a foam roller for 45 minutes to accomplish. Did anybody follow that logic with the foam roller? Yeah, some of you know what I'm talking about. Cool. So you can have a seat. Thank you very much. Somebody else come up. Look how much fun he had. Okay, good. Thank you. Don't you all want to be just like him? And hey, this guy gets a Twix bar.
A melted Twix bar.
Could you be a little more grateful? Because, I mean, it is. It may be melted. All tastes the same. So, do you have any injuries or surgeries I should be aware of? I don't want to.
Not recent.
Any at all?
Wait,
I feel like you're lying to me. Yeah.
Like how recent?
At all, because I want to make sure I don't touch something and break you.
Oh, no, I'm good then.
Any surgeries, ever?
I'm good.
You're being very difficult. Any surgeries ever?
Yeah.
Okay, any, like, in lower body?
No.
Okay, you're being very elusive. We're going to do this anyway, but I'm not making any promises. So pop your shoes off. Cool. So let's see. I still want your shoes off. Okay. We're going to do wrist drills. So I'm going to have you face me, stand in tall spine, feet in neutral, so kick your heels out. Cool. We're going to mobilize the joints in, what's your name?
David.
In David's wrists. So I'm going to have you do one at a time. Rest. So the drill looks like this. We're just going up and down. But I'm going to first give you a little bit of skin stim. So look straight ahead. We're doing a little bit of sensory input. So we want to make sure his brain knows this is where we're focusing right now. Because, again, the best cue you can give yourself, guys, is just pay attention. Just pay attention to whatever you're doing. It sounds really silly, but it makes a huge difference. So I want you to, with really tall spines, we want a nice, fully functioning cerebellum. I want you to just glide your wrist up and then glide it down. Glide it up, glide it down. Oh my God, I'm a terrible coach. We didn't do an assessment. We're doing great. So hold on, I'm going to jam this because I want to undo all the good we just did. Okay, face them. Let's see a forward bend.
Wait, what?
I'm doing great. I just undid the opening. So I want to see a forward bend because I want to see where you're at. Okay, good. Do it one more time. Cool. Face me. We're gonna open this joint again. So, cool thing is, it's really quick. You can do it really fast. Stand in neutral again. Cool. Nice tall spine. We're back to the wrist. Redo. Okay. Elbow in. And just glide up and down. Make sure you're breathing. Looking really, really, really tall. Take your time. Go a little bit slower with this. Relax that other hand. You're doing a really good job, actually, with the relaxation. Okay. So we're going to see if doing just the right one, keep going, gives him any more forward flexion or if he needs to do both. But we just did one right now, so face them. Do a little bounce. Stand really tall. Roll down. See how far you can go. Okay, a little bit more, not a lot more. So I'm going to see what happens now when I do the other wrist. So back in neutral, give me a really nice tall spine. Okay, stand really tall, make sure you're breathing. Mobilize this one for me. Keep the elbow down, shoulder down. So we're just moving the wrist. Come into where I'm tapping. Come into where I'm tapping. Feel where I'm tapping. Feel where I'm tapping. So this is what my warm-up looks like. Wash on, wash off. Pet the kitty, pet the kitty. Paint the fence, paint the fence. That's my warm-up. Everybody around me is doing like squats and stretches and hamstring kicks, and I'm like, pet the kitty, pet the kitty. And I'm more limber than all of them. Okay, keep going. This one doesn't really want to move as well,
Sorry.
No, it's okay. You're doing good. You didn't have surgery here, did you? Because I'm still feeling like you're lying to me.
No.
Okay, look straight ahead. Really tall.
Broke both my arms, but that's different.
Oh, okay. He broke one of his arms. Don't expect this to give him a very good payoff. Face this way. Bounce on the heels. Forward bend. Okay. He did get some. He didn't go palms to the floor. But, again, he just told me finally, after a lot of just begging, that he broke both of his arms. So do you think that he might have, still, my friend, do you think that he might have SMA in his arms? Cool. So what we would do then is, so that's a big injury to break both of your arms. Doing 10 wrist glides is not going to immediately erase the problem. But do you think maybe if you do wrist glides a couple of times a day, every day for maybe 2 weeks or so, you might have palms to the floor too?
Yeah.
Because you're going to give your brain so much more information about your arms, so much more mechanoreceptive activity. So that actually would be a really good drill for you, as long as there's no pain.
Okay.
Good. Pop your shoes on. Have a seat. You get recess. Yeah. There you go. All right, let's do one more. Somebody come up. We're going to do a vision drill. Who wants to do a vision drill? Yes, in the scarf. Because the scarf is so pretty, and I would love one just like it. You're going to have to take your shoes off. So the reason I'm having everybody take their shoes off, it's not just because I just don't feel like wearing shoes, which is also true. It's because shoes jam joints in your feet, unless you have really good shoes. Toms, not so much, because they're pretty flexible. But so we, in order to have our best shot at success here, I want to make sure that we're not jamming joints in our feet, which is where most of the proprioceptive information comes from. So standing nice and tall, any medical history I should know about? Okay, cool. Any head trauma? Yeah? Okay, in that case, we're going to do a chair. Because sometimes, if you've had head trauma and you do vision drills, you get dizzy and nauseous. If you feel like you're going to throw up, please do it outside. Okay, sit right there for me. All right, so, oh, God, I'm really nervous. I thought somebody was actually going to throw up. So let's test something. Let's test. Should we stick with forward bend, or you want to? Yeah, let's stick with forward bend. It's just the easiest with tight clothes on. So actually, stand up for me. Show them what how much forward bend you have. Okay, do it like two more times, just kind of to warm up. Okay, make sure you let your head drop. Good. So about to first knuckle. Have a seat. We're gonna do a pencil push up. So did you have any high payoff after the peripheral vision drill? Did you do any feel any kind of clarity? Okay, cool.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to do a pencil push-up, which is going to be a, oh, I do have a pencil. I was going to say it was going to be a finger push-up, but here we go. So this is going to test her ability to converge and diverge her eyes. So I'll show you guys with me. So when I track this pencil in, my eyes should go cross-eyed. I should have that ability. I've been training it for long enough. And then I tracked it, right? Another way to pick up men. Go into a bar and do this. So I should be able to converge and diverge my eyes. A lot of times, just like, and so for anybody who has a hard time with letter ball, it probably means that at some point between here and here, your brain loses the ability to track that object into your eyes. So that can be super threatening, because when do you need convergence and divergence? I don't know, when you're driving, when signs are coming towards you, that's kind of important. When you're walking and a person is coming towards you, also kind of important. So this guy knows what I'm talking about. I see that. There we go. Okay, so we're going to track, and we're going to see what her eyes do. They might do really cool things. If you do get dizzy or anything, just let me know. Turn away. So sit really, you look so scared. It's going to be fine. Sit really tall. Okay, and I want you to just track this. Good. They're laughing with you. They're not laughing at you. I just did it. It's fine. You're pretty. There we go. You're actually doing remarkably well. I was really hoping you'd be fun and have one eye that didn't work, but I have a video on my phone of somebody's eye who doesn't work. You can see me after. I'll show you. It's really funny. Actually, I might have signed like a confidentiality thing. Maybe I can't do that. Okay. Shake it out. Stand up. Just take a walk to the end and back just to give your brain a chance to kind of process. Let's reassess that forward bend. Whoa. Ah, yeah. Raise your hand if you own a pencil. do this drill all the time. It will do really good things for you. Thank you for coming up and doing that. So, gosh, this flew by. We have about 15 minutes left. I want to show you one more video talking about vision training. I have to move all the candy out of the way. Picture on. Oh, I'm going to move my slides. Hold on. So this is a quick little YouTube video about a guy who uses what they call a BrainPort vision device. He's blind. He's learning to see through his tongue. So I figured what's going to drive home the whole neuroplasticity thing more than this guy can see and play tic-tac-toe by putting something on his tongue. So I just wanted you guys to see this and...
Your brain is what really sees, not your eyes. If your eyes don't work, and you can create another portal into the brain, then your brain is what is going to interpret the world around you. BrainPort is essentially a camera that translates a video image to a plate that I wear in my mouth. Dad. Hundreds of pixels on the plate tingle on my tongue, and together they form patterns and shapes that my brain interprets as the space around me.
The information is the same whether you collect it from your eyes or from our cameras with a tongue display. He knows a lot about his environment already through the sense of sound and touch, and this adds one more piece to the puzzle.
I think it's amazing that I can look on the screen and see that his brain is tracing a number and able to figure out what it is.
31.
Very good. Okay.
Stone, paper, scissors, shoot. I'm just at the beginning of this stage, but I think you could take this innovation so much farther than probably anyone knows.
Now you can zoom into what you just did and find your O.
I'm laughing because I think I beat you.
Dick.
You don't?
Ha ha ha. I won.
I thought I had a circle on the left, circle in the middle, and a circle down at the bottom. But didn't I have a circle on the top left?
No.
You stinker, no. Emma.
Oh, yeah. We both won.
No, we didn't win both way.
I can see it. I can see it. I just can't grab it.
It's just a trip for me to be able to look at a hold and reach for it. It's a trip for me to be able to have Emma put her hand out and me be able to see what she's doing. To me, it's like beyond science. It's just, it's wild. It's a wild experience.
Cool, what'd you guys think of that? It is pretty amazing. Cool. So let me remember. This is a lot of gadgets for me. Oh, good. So, okay. First of all, any thoughts on that before we kind of do our last thing here? Yeah.
Is it like an actual image that's being displayed? Is it like something like Braille where you can feel it via tongue?
I think it's vibration, and so but the vibration is causing an image to form in his brain. I'm not 100% clear on that. I think that's what it is. I haven't studied this in depth at all. It's just a video I found after I read this book, The Brain That Changes Itself. I started just like YouTubing stories, and this is one of the ones I found. But yeah, if you want to Google BrainPort vision device, you can learn all about it. So yeah.
Just because the tongue's so sensitive, it's kind of inconvenient.
It's really, you know what? Now I feel like I wish I had done more research on the BrainPort vision device. I don't actually know. I just thought it was a really good display of neuroplasticity, which is why I showed that video. Fail, sorry. But you can look it up, Brainport Vision Device. So here's what I want to do to end this before our little Q&A. Don't ask hard questions, because clearly I'm not good with answers. So I put my information up on the board in case you want it. We have this list that we started in the beginning of things that you guys wish you can change. I would love it if a couple of you could come up with everything that we've just learned, could come up with something I can do, a drill. Let's say I want to improve my reading and writing. Raise your hand and tell me something I can do for that. Yes. Absolutely. Do you have one of these balls yet? Would you like one? Yeah. What? Oh, yes, it does. I don't give things away for free. What do you think I am? Ready?
Yeah.
Good. Good. And do you see how much better the second catch was from the first? Because now your brain can predict what's going to happen. The first time it came towards you, your brain didn't know it was happening. Now your brain is starting to be able to predict. And so it's feeling safer. And you're doing better. Hold on to that. Practice with that. That's a really good tool. So, oh yeah, all yours. So, give me some ideas, guys, on how I could tackle some of this stuff on the board. Somebody, anybody. I'll get the candy again. I feel like you don't want to answer anything unless I have candy in my hand. Oh, this is really melted. I'm sorry. Yeah, somebody, something. Fix something.
Neck pain.
Neck pain. Fix it. What would you do? That's a disassociation tactic. That's awesome. Somebody else, fix something. What's a drill I could do for something on the board? Anything we just learned. What can I train?
Less stress.
For what?
Less stress.
What can I do?
Doing less treading.
Who said that? What did you say, sir?
Doing less treading. I feel less treading by doing drills.
Mm-hmm. So maybe trying to conserve a little bit of frontal brain, new brain energy. Yeah, cool. Ooh, I almost missed. Yes. Somebody? Anybody? Because I feel like I let you down if you can't give me any ideas. Yeah.
For waking up earlier, don't make it such a terrible thing. Have something good to wake up to.
Yeah.
Like positive so that you're not dreading it.
Change your filter. Nice. Somebody, sorry, that was aggressive. I don't know where that came from. Apparently I have some pent-up anger. I'll do an underhand next time. Yeah. You could. It doesn't have to be on the list. I'm very easygoing.
Enjoying a certain environment.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, with a party situation, go in with a different thought.
Yeah, because thoughts become things.
Yeah.
Right on. That's for you. Here you go.
Oh, thanks.
Okay.
I got it.
I feel like that might have been my fault. I'm going to take that one. I'm going to take that on me. So that's basically all I wanted to cover with you guys today. Some very, very basic information. Do you have any questions? Yes.
Does this play in with kind of like how Mary Lou Henner has like a super memory? Like, does that, I don't know, the neuroplasticity? Like,
I don't know much about that in particular, but memory, yes, is a skill. And a skill is untrained or trained with as much focus as you put on that skill. And so if she's putting a lot of focus on the skill of memory, then her memory, that skill is going to get really, really good. Kind of, I don't really know much about that particular case, but it's a skill like anything else, yeah.
Well, like she can remember like everything. Like mm-hmm. You can give her a date and a time and she knows exactly what she was doing, wearing, the temperature.
Yeah, so I would have to research that, but it sounds like her brain is just wired in a very cool and unique way. Anybody else have general questions about brain training? Yeah.
No, I don't.
Well, what's your question? Maybe I can answer it.
What kind of education do you have?
Do I have?
Yeah,
so, I, and you can write this down. Guys, I have more candy. You don't all have to run away. It's very much a letdown. So I studied a place called ZHealth. And you can write that down. You can go to zhealth.net. It's right in Tempe. It's actually why I came here, so I could be closer to the source of my education. And it is the only educational facility that teaches a brain-based approach to athletic training. it's a really, really cool place, and I've taken quite a large number of courses from them. And that's where I've learned all of my neuroscience, my anatomy, all my courses through them. Yes?
How many out of 40 does our brain pick up?
How many what?
How many out of 40 again?
Ah, so every second we receive about 40 million signals, and we have the ability to become conscious of about 40 of them. Yeah? Any famous athletes? No. I know, it's very anticlimactic. I wish I could say yes. I've had a very uncool, you know, history of just helping regular people. Yeah?
I'll send RG3 your way.
Who's that?
I'll send RG3 your way.
Oh, God, who's that? Should I know that? It's only laughing at me. Should I have just pretended that I knew? Okay,
yeah.
Next time. Yeah.
So, you said with the CRPS that you have.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So
I'm very familiar with that concept.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how you would go around. Yep.
So here's specifically what I would do. I would, first of all, so if it's neurogenic pain, I would eliminate all sensory input. I'm obviously not skin stimming my knee. Before the last stop for me, let's say it's a knee, the last stop for me is working on the knee. First, I would mobilize the joints above and below on the same side. So I would mobilize the ankle and the hip. I would mobilize the opposing joint, so the opposing elbow. I would do visual and vestibular drills, and then I would stack them. So I would do a visual drill while doing an elbow circle. So I would just do as much as I could before down the line, eventually starting to gently mobilize that knee. And when you are able to kind of decrease yourself of fear enough to get somebody into a position where they're actually mobilizing that knee, there is usually no mechanical pain. Because the pain is so, it's neurogenic, it's so sensory oriented, that usually there's no actual pain with mechanical issues. It's more of a fear of pain that causes all that pain. And so if I can decrease the threat enough, and honestly, when I deal with people with that kind of pain, in the beginning it's all games. It's all stuff like letter balls, you get my last ball. So I want you to use this with your clients, because here's the thing, fear of pain is always worse than the pain itself. And so if you can get them focused on something really, really fun. So in my studio, it's just I have different balls. I have ping pong things. It's just games. Because first of all, this is joint mobilization also. You're getting a lot of elbow mobility during this. It's training your eyes. It's decreasing threat. And they're moving before they even know they're moving. So like I had this guy, 65. This is one of my clients back in New York. His doctor had told him he needed a double knee replacement and had put the fear of God in him that he should never walk down a flight of stairs again for the rest of his life, or he would have no more cartilage, which, by the way, is not a thing. You can't have no cartilage. You wouldn't be able to move. So, but that they use that term because they want you to, you know, rein it in. This guy thought, if I ever walk down a stair, I will implode and pass away. And that's how serious his fear was. And he was in agony, man. He was in so much pain. And his doctor had put so much fear in him. And so I wanted him to walk down the stairs because I'm like that. And I'm like, he tells me I'm not going to walk down the stairs. And I'm like, well, you're going to walk down the stairs. So first of all, we did about 15 minutes of this. And he loved this because it reminded him of being a kid and his dad, something with the dad, I don't know. He liked playing cat. So he got very distracted because he was having a really good time. And then I leveled with him. So I said, here's the deal. I was working at a crunch gym at the time, 3 levels. So I said, we're going to strengthen your quads. So I want you to walk up, like a nice little athletic march, walk up the stairs, and then we'll take the elevator down. Because do you guys know what stair runs are? Like a form of cardio. So instead of having my clients sit on the treadmill, I'll just have them run up and down the stairs. Long story short, it's a much, much better version of cardio for your brain. We won't get into that now. But I wanted him to, I just decided, his doctor told him he can't do stairs, he's going to do stair runs. 65, needs 2 knee replacements. So I said, we were playing this game, I got him really, really relaxed. I said, okay, you are going to jog, because he had no pain jogging up the stairs. It was a you know, like a jog. But I said, you're going to jog up the stairs, and then we're going to take the elevator down. You're going to jog up the stairs, we're going to take the elevator down. So he said, fine. So we did that, and we're doing that a couple of times. But I just pulled every game I could find, every vision game, every, like, I just put so many games in this exercise that I got him so confused about what we were doing. And he, before I knew it, I didn't say anything, but he stopped going to the elevator. He started taking the stairs. And he realized there was no pain. But he was so afraid of the pain and the fear, what was giving him so much pain. And I got him so distracted because I'm so charming and fun that he forgot that he was supposed to be afraid and then realized that he didn't actually have a lot of pain there. And then once the fear of movement was gone, then we were able to actually train it and actually strengthen the knee and mobilize it and work on the joints in the surrounding area. I know my time is up, I know. So this is for you. Cool. I'm getting the it's time to go look, but my information is up there and I'm happy to email each and every one of you. Thank you so much for coming and listening. Thank you.
Security is going.
Oh, security once more. Oh, goodness. Okay. Well, thank you very much.